So I'm here today to share with you my experience, both as an artist and as a woman. I was born in Beirut in 1957 to Youssef Shuker from the village of Arsoun and Salwa Rauda from Ras Beirut. Both my parents were in their 40s when I arrived at the Khalidi Hospital on Sidani Street, two blocks away from here, becoming their only child. My mother was a pioneer abstract artist and my father a government civil servant. We lived in the Rauda family building on that same street with my grandmother, my uncle, my aunt, and my cousins. That setting for an only child was like heaven. It provided me with the sibling that my father had long refused to have, in addition to the joy of growing up with the aroma of my grandmother's kitchen. The doors of our apartments were always open, so I would head straight to that kitchen after school. There, I always find some leftovers waiting for me in the mesh cupboard, namliye, or hidden baked goods in tin boxes. Although my mother was always around, her time was mostly spent in her studio on the upper floor, working on her art. This idyllic setting was sprinkled by my mother's activities and creativity. I was allowed to draw on the walls of our apartment, and my pencil marks remained there to my embarrassment for many years. Just like my mother, I was always doing something with my hands. I painted the cover of my baby album when I was a toddler and won a prize for clay sculptures when I was 7. As a teenager, I had the walls of my room plastered with photos of movie stars, but since they did not mean much to me, I took the liberty of transforming their faces into all kinds of collages. Then the Civil War broke out in 1975 and everything changed. Traumatized by the killing of a relative, my mom made me leave for Paris on a very short notice, catching the last flights before the airport was forced to shut down. I was 19 years old. I had barely settled there when I read in the newspaper that our village had been shelled and sacked. My grandmother was able to flee but was never able to return to her home. Next to those experiences, I was trying to understand the mysteries of the universe and our complex minds, and trying to figure out my identity, what it meant to be a Druze and an Arab woman. My thesis at the Sorbonne, focusing on a Japanese film, made me explore Far East art and religion, as well as many other spiritual subjects. My search to unveil the secrets multiplied my interest, shaped my character, and changed the way I eat and breathe. I started drawing in ink with very fine ballpoint pens, women with endless details occupying desolate spaces. After graduation and following immense pressure from my parents, I returned to Lebanon, where I tried to manage on my own. I had few jobs but never stopped painting, despite the shelling, the snipers, and the car bombs. As the war intensified in 1987, I left Lebanon again, this time to the United States, where I settled in Washington, D.C. There, I was able to sell a considerable amount of paintings. On my first visit to New York, I was fortunate enough to meet a very fine gentleman who happened to be from a village 5 minutes away from mine. We got married a year later, and we still live in New York, parents to two lovely daughters. As a mother, living in a foreign city without any family support, raising my kids was a full-time job. However, I was able to insert my art into games I prepared for them. Then I joined the Art Student League of New York, where I started spending more hours there as their school days grew longer. In the meantime, my parents on the other side of the Atlantic suffered tremendously from years of endless war. They aged quickly and needed me. After my father passed away, my mother could not continue working an art book she had started. So my visits to Lebanon became more frequent to help with the book, and I was torn, stretched between two continents. The book was finally published. Mother would spend endless hours examining its pages and admiring her lifelong creations, all included in one consolidated volume. I later curated a retrospective for her work, and she came to see it on a wheelchair. That was the last time she left home before passing away. Then I decided that I should pursue my life as an artist. I ended up simplifying my material using one color and one brush on a small paper. And this is how it all started, exactly at the end. The title of my first show of these works on paper was Grains of Light. The small repetitive movement allows me to enter a personal, intimate space to capture this fleeting moment. How light catches dust. I wanted to share memories I encoded in place and time. My long, thin brush is full of paint. It rests on the white paper. I breathe in continuous circles. The flow forms the deep well. My brush grows empty. The tool and the hand inform the mind, and the mind follows. I also like to think about the notion of time and the mechanism of perception, the temporal illusions of our brain. If I'm showing time, does it matter how much time I take? I am collecting memories, freezing time on a piece of paper. It is time I give. In my last exhibition, titled You Promised Me Spring, I showed colors on large canvas. It is nature and its intricacies. It is the happiness of a moment when we look deeply into a grain of sand, when we discover that inside a pine shell, there is a nut covered by a thin layer, when we look inside the core of an artichoke, when we hear the sound between two sounds. In conclusion, my memory often takes me back to that old house on Sedan Street with its green shutters. The sun is seeping through the glass of the dining room window, and my mother is all smiles, pouring olive oil over my plate. This is the only color that matters. This is the warm light that I keep looking for.